morning. Welcome to Worship at Adventure. We are so glad you're here. Would you stand and join us as we lift our praises to God?
Let the waters come and the earth give way. while the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. And I feel my heart.
I invite you to take a seat and turn your attention to the screens for Life at Adventure.
Good morning, Adventure family, and welcome to Life at Adventure. Let's jump right into announcements this morning. Today, we will finish up our Forward Framework series with a sermon about the Book of Acts and a bunch of tools available to help us be equipped and encouraged as we seek to devote ourselves ever increasingly to Christ and one another through these examples laid out in the first century church. Pastor CJ would love if you have a paper Bible today. So if you're at home, make sure to grab one. And if you're in the building and don't have one, there are Bibles available at the entrances to both the Worship and Friendship Centers, and they're also at the Welcome Center. And if you don't own a Bible, you are welcome to take one of those copies home. Next week, we'll be kicking off an 8-week sermon series called Beautiful Community. We'll be digging into how the early disciples lived and how their selflessness, their devotion, their authenticity and focus, and how they were filled with the Holy Spirit, how all of those things spurred them as a community and out on mission to transform the world. We are praying that this sermon series will be a catalyst for us as we learn how these followers of Jesus completely changed their lives, reorienting them to be centered on the resurrected Savior and living lives that reflected him to the watching world. If you missed it last week, we're making a push to not just get, but stay connected as we head into these spring and summer months. At Adventure, we value relationships, and intentionally living into them is part of our core value statements, and we want to live it out together. So find the forum linked in the weekly newsletter and get and stay connected.
Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 through 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.
Just a reminder that next week at the end of service, we will be installing Pastor CJ as our senior pastor. Even though we already voted him in, installation is a requirement from the presbytery and from ECO. So after service, we want to do the installation and then celebrate together as a church family. So bring a picnic lunch and we will provide some dessert treats and plan on staying after to celebrate. Just a reminder that you can always find this info and more in the weekly newsletter. Any links we mentioned can be found there, and more information. Like this week, we added a monthly update from Session. And you can always find the link for the weekly newsletter right on the homepage of our website. Whether you are in the Worship Center, the Friendship Center, the parking lot, online, or later on YouTube, we are just so glad that you have joined us in worship today.
Hello, I'm Aiden, and I'll be reading Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Amen. Thanks, Aiden. Would you stand and join me as we continue in worship singing Graves into Gardens? pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us here today to worship you and to learn more about you. God, I ask that you give us open hearts as we come into the sermon today so that we can better know your mission for us and we can go out and complete that. In your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayers. And awe came over every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as they had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food from glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the numbers day by day those who were being saved.
All right. I think by the end of this sermon series, we should have those verses memorized because I bring them up constantly. So today we're continuing the Forward Framework sermon series. The first week we covered those verses kind of from a 30,000 foot view. Last week we talked about Pastor Luke, the author of Luke and Acts, and kind of gave us a history of his life. And remember, we talked about the pronoun shift in Acts 16. You guys remember that conversation? Where we got really excited about the different pronouns? No, just me, okay. I'm just going to say we because that makes it more inclusive. We also talked about how the book of Acts doesn't end, even though it does end in chapter 28, that we become Acts 29 because the church continues through us and the Holy Spirit's continuing to work through us, and we're going to kind of build on that theme today. So this morning is going to be kind of a different type of sermon, but I feel like I'm going to say that every week because I preach weird. So that's just how we do. So you're going to see me get a little nerdy, and I'm sorry. Is that sorry, not sorry? Is that what kids say? Yeah, sorry, not sorry. Yeah, and we're going to kind of talk about a little bit about Bible translations, which is a cool God thing this morning. The sound team or some of the worship team was talking about this morning. They were talking about different translations when I came in, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is so cool. It's like God's working. And then we're going to talk about kind of do a book walk, what teachers call a book walk through the book of Acts, and we'll just kind of flip through the big picture, 30,000 foot view of that book. So, to start us off, let's talk a little bit about the Bible and how we received this book that we hold in our hands to start us off. So in its earliest stages, the books of the Hebrew Bible were individually written and copied onto papyrus. Okay, we have little pictures to show you what they looked like. Okay, which were very similar to the paper we use today. Obviously, it's much more coarse. And then they were rolled them around a small wooden dowel to form a scroll, which is probably what you've seen before. And then over centuries, these scrolls were slowly accumulated among various Hebrew communities. There was one translation, but they were written down from oral histories, a single oral history, and hand-copied the same one over and over again. Okay. Now, due to its better durability, papyrus was gradually replaced by parchment beginning in 200 BCE. 200 BCE. It's formed from the tanned hides of calves. Our earliest surviving manuscripts of the Hebrew Bible were written on both papyrus and parchment. We have some of both, actually. Papyrus are what the Dead Sea Scrolls, if you've heard of those, were written on. These were scrolls that were found near Qumran on the northwest shore of the Dead Sea in 1947, which wasn't that long ago. And these are the earliest surviving manuscripts of the Hebrew Bible. It has all the books except for the Book of Esther. It has all of them. They predate our next earliest manuscripts, the Masoretic text, by about 1,000 years. So can you imagine, like, when they found these, how excited they were? Now, the Dead Sea Scrolls are written by the Essenes. They're a Jewish apocalyptic fringe group it's really actually kind of a funny story. When they saw Jerusalem living a different way and they had different theological convictions, they took all their Bibles and they ran up to the hills and they sat up there waiting for God to smite them, and then they died up there. So it was kind of their thing, but they kept good records, and it was great that we have these copies. So there was almost 200 biblical scrolls. There's some really cool pictures. I don't have time to show you them, but you can look them up. Google Dead Sea Scrolls, and you'll see these rooms packed with little scraps of paper, because they were somewhere parchment, and painstakingly, without computers, these guys had to figure out which book they were from a tiny fragment, and then put them together painstakingly. This was several people's life work, and now we can just Google it and look at it, and it's beautiful. But anyway, the first known translation of the Hebrew Bible into Greek is called the Septuagint. Okay, you've probably heard of that before. The LXX, this is what it looks like. The reason it's called the Septuagint, it comes from the Latin word for 70, because it was attributed to 70 Palestinian scholars that first translated this. And it was translated from 285 to 246 BCE. Now, the Septuagint includes all of the Hebrew text. This was the Bible that Jesus was likely reading, okay? The copies of this. So in the first and second century, the New Testament consisted of individual books like the Gospels and letters written on scrolls that were copied and shared amongst churches in the ancient Near East. They were just shared around. So when Paul would write a letter to a church, they would read it in front, and then the person reading would often tell people what it meant and give you an update, a personal update from Paul or whoever wrote it. And then they would hand it on to other churches. And these were just passed around. Now, pretty soon churches started going, hey, I want a copy of this so we can read it again. So they would painstakingly copy these letters before they handed them on, and that became a common practice during this time. Now, what's interesting is that all of these letters and books became known as the New Testament. Now, they didn't call it that, and they didn't have it all wrapped up together, but there was they considered them authoritative. There was no debate about their authorship. They knew who they came from. And then they just all believed. There wasn't actually a lot of argument. A lot of us have heard stories or seen movies or read terrible books that talk about all the debates and how there were some guys sitting in a dark room throwing out books of the Bible and things like that. Honestly, guys, we have tons of historical data. This didn't happen. It's do some research. Again, the second time, Google it. It's not that hard. The Third Council of Carthage in 397, they made this drastic, everyone, when you read about this, you always say, 397 AD, that's what we're supposed to say now, right? 397 CE, they decided what books would be in the New Testament. This was like the easiest piece of legislation ever, because everyone was already doing it. There was seriously no debate about the New Testament canon. There wasn't we're not gonna use the book of James. Oh no, we're not gonna use this other book. There was no debate. They just said, hey, are these the books? Yeah, they're the books that we're already using. Oh, okay, we're gonna make an official decision to make something, rubber stamp something that's already happened. It was not a debate. Now, during this time in the fourth century, after this, the fourth century CE, Christianity had flourished. And the codex became the preferred method among scribes for copying the Bible. Now, codices kind of look like what we think of when we think of a Bible. They're parchment sheets folded over and sewn together to create a series of turnable pages. So it's a manuscript form, and it looks like this. It kind of looks like a book, like an early book. And this was how the Greek New Testament and Greek Old Testament was written on. Now, in the late 4th century, Jerome, who you should also read, translated the Bible into Latin under the commission of Pope Damascus I in 382. Now, this would become known as the Latin Vulgate. You've probably heard of this as well. This is the official Bible of the Roman Catholic Church. A lot of Roman Catholic churches still read from the Vulgate. They still read from this translation. It's modern, it's copied, but it's still this translation that was done years and years ago. It has not been updated. Now, from the 7th to the 10th century, we have copies of the Hebrew Bibles written by the Masoretes. Remember, this is the one that we had for the longest time before the Dead Sea Scrolls. This was what everything was translated from the Old Testament. And this is called the MT, or the Masoretic Text, is what we call it. This is a primary source for contemporary editions of the Hebrew Bible of the Old Testament. Now, the cool part about this Old Testament is you look, the little dots and tittles and stuff, they actually started adding accent marks on these texts to make you be able to read them aloud and pronounce them. Before, it was just commonly known that everyone knew how to say it, but these guys added little accent marks. So up until this point, up until the early 13th century, there were no chapters, there were no verses. So when you get to heaven someday and you're sitting with the Apostle Paul and you say, what did you mean in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2? He's going to have no idea what you're talking about because he did not have chapters or verses. So you'll have to just quote the verse in its entirety because they memorized the whole thing. That's what they did. So good reason to memorize the scriptures. So the Archbishop of Canterbury in the 13th century added chapters, but there were still no verses. Those weren't added until much later in the mid-16th century. So verses aren't that common. It's been around for years and years and years. I mean, it's like yesterday in historical thinking. Now, in the late 14th century, the Bible was made accessible to lay people who didn't know Latin through the Wycliffe Bible. You've heard of this? They still produce these. Have you heard of these? You can get them. They were done in English. John Wycliffe did them. He finished translating both the Old and the New Testament. He did this from the Vulgate, from the Latin, in 1383. Now, this freaked out the English church so much that they condemned his translation and forbade any future translation. They did not like the idea of someone taking it on their own to be able to translate the scriptures. But then comes Martin Luther, who was a bit of a rebel. And he protested the administrative corruption of the Roman Catholic Church, and so he translated the Bible into German. And he based it on the original Hebrew and Greek, though. He got the original text and looked at those. It didn't go off the Vulgate. So he translated this about 1525, a little bit before that. But in 1525, William Tyndale printed the first English translation of the biblical books. And it was, again, directly from the Greek and Hebrew into English. A horribly difficult task to do. Imagine no computers, doing it entirely on your own in a room. And now there's huge committees of people that do this. But he did this, and for all his efforts, all his work, the Church of England caught on, and they burned Tyndale and many of his translations at the stake. So he was burned, and so were his books. Only to find, in 10 years later, the first authorized English Bible, the Great Bible, as it's called, in 1539, they used Tyndale's translation and translated it. So they used, after burning him and his books, you know, a few years earlier, you know, it's like 10 years, 14 years ahead of time. And then they translated the Geneva Bible in 1560 from the Greek and Hebrew text. So this was not using Tyndale's, but all the way back. And it became, this is the Bible that they brought with them on the Mayflower. So this was the Bible that most people read. This was a common Bible. In fact, a lot of your ancient Christians that we read about, these are what they read, the Puritans, this is what they read. And civilians loved this translation, but it fell into disfavor by the ruling Anglicans. And so the Church of England, this influenced the Church of England and King James I to commission his favorite, his famous authorized version, which is called King Jimmy, right? The King James Version, okay? Now this was done in 1611. And the translation was done by 47 scholars who James instructed very clearly. He said, there's one thing, I want you to translate it, I want you to translate it well. And they did. They did a great job. These guys were great people. I'm not trying to knock the King James Version. But the king did have a point. It was a little politicized. He said, make sure that you uplift and support the ordination of clergy. Make sure the church and clergy are of utmost importance in your translation. So they had that in the back of their heads the whole time they were translating. Now, there were several translations done since then, especially since finding the Dead Sea Scrolls. And these use a lot of historical documents and help make for better translation, richer translations now. Today, they're done, translations are done a little differently. They're not commissioned by some body. They are, but not by some governmental body or some by the church at large. They're done for different purposes oftentimes. So oftentimes these translations dance on this spectrum between literal word-for-word translations as close as they can to more paraphrased translations. And there's this kind of a spectrum that you see here. And if you look on the left there, it's the more literal interlinear Bibles or Bibles that have like the Greek or Hebrew text, and then right underneath they have the actual English word. Those are nearly impossible to read, for the record. They're really hard to read. And then on the right, you have like the Message Bible, which is a modern translation, which is very much a paraphrase. It's for easy reading, it's for understanding. It's so you can sit down and read it. Now, the ones on the right are much easier to read, but the further left you lean, the farther left you move on the chart, I wanna make sure you gotta be careful about left-leaning stuff now, you get to more literal translations. And these aren't bad, they're harder to read, but if you do like word studies, you want to kind of lean a little further to the left on that chart, okay? And they make it harder to read, just fluently, like reading day to day, but they do make it easier to do research studies and stuff. But this begs the question, we have so many English translations now, what translation should we read? And for that, I have a short video.
There are many translations of the Bible, so which one should you read? In short, read as many as you can, because no one does everything, because they're designed for different purposes, and using many translations will give you a well-rounded understanding. Every translation is balancing two goals. First is faithfulness to the wording of the original language, and the second is readability in normal English. Place these on a spectrum, and you get word-for-word translations up here and thought-for-thought translations down here. Word-for-word translations try to imitate the original language and so require you, the reader, to do more interpretive work yourself. Thought-for-thought translations do more interpretive work for you by paraphrasing what they think the text means, and most translations are somewhere in the middle. Now, keep in mind that no Bible translation can perfectly represent what's in the original language, because no two languages are identical. So pay attention to when translations differ, and try to read as many Bible translations as you can.
Short and sweet. So, which translation should we read? Lots of them, okay? They're all good ones, even ones that have these political motivations. The cool part about modern Bibles is that in that first section, they have that introduction section that we all skip and jump right to the Bible. In that, you can read about who translated this, what team, what were their theological leanings, and why they leaned that way. So that way, when you're reading, you're aware, as much as you know, of the author's biases, as it were, right? So when they translate, they tend to translate that way, okay? If we want to read like the best translation ever, what should we read? Greek and Hebrew, right, Greek and Hebrew. But we live in such a great society, we don't have to do that anymore. We can just totally Google it, again, Google it, okay? Google's our savior at this point for getting to Greek and Hebrew. But the idea, we can Google all these things, and learning Greek and Hebrew isn't an impossibility anymore. You don't have to go to seminary. It's. I would say, don't be intimidated by these languages. You can look them up and there's a lot of help. But if you read lots of translations, lots of different translations, that's almost a good workaround for learning Greek and Hebrew, because as you see these words pop up and how they're used differently in different translations, what you'll see is like this full bigger picture of what this word means. So instead of just the word love that we use in English, where we say, I love pizza and I love my mom, we don't mean the same thing, right? But it's nuanced. The word is the same and spelled the same. In Greek, there's different words for those things. And so you can get the nuance of this is a different kind of love. This is a special kind of love. This has a different meaning. And you get that just from reading different translations. So this morning, before we get to our book walk, what I wanted to do was do a short commercial break. So I want to suggest some Bibles and study tools that you might not know about that you could write down and say, hey, I'm going to check this out because they're really cool. I use a lot of these. I would just suggest, like, again, having a myriad of different types. So let me talk about them. I'm going to walk over here, camera people. There you go. I told you I was going to keep you on your toes. So what I thought I'd do first is talk to you about some different translations that are super modern. So the first two I want to talk about, this one is the Christian Standard Bible. Okay, if you're looking for a typical Bible that is readable in today's modern language, check this guy out. I think this, as far as my knowledge, is the most recent translation done in English. So you can check it out, Christian Standard Bible. Last year, I think, you could get them for free if you registered online at the site or something, and they just send you one. They just sent me this one. So it's really cool to read. Some of it, I swear, like, they're almost writing in emojis. So it's some of it's like, wow, that's a huge leap. But that's a good one. Another one is done by N.T. Wright and John Goldingay, yeah. This is a Bible for everyone, okay? It's written, very plain language, easy to understand. It does have some references to it, but it's a really, really easy to understand, and it gets to the heart of the overarching theme from beginning to end of the Bible. So again, if you've never read anything by N.T. Wright, strongly suggest this Bible, so give it a shot. Another Bible for you, we call these Bible, if you're a cheater Bible is what we call these. These are study Bibles, okay? This is the study Bible, and what it has is every chapter has like books, and then at the bottom they have all these notes, okay? So oftentimes when I'm working with a small group or if I'm working with you, there's a line here, right? You see the line, okay? Above the line, the Bible. Below the line, not the Bible, okay? These are commentaries, okay? This is someone's opinion about this up here, okay? So just know that when you're reading it. Super helpful. If they're really thick, kind of cumbersome to keep in your purse or in your bag or in your back pocket, but super helpful for giving you a context for where it's happening. There's no question that's unanswered. There's also often digital versions of this that can help you with it as well. So, on that note, though, I wanted to say the coolest Bible that Candace Brady actually turned me on to recently is, anybody read the New Living Translation? It's a semi-new translation as well. Really easy to read, easy to flow, okay? But this one is called the Filament Bible. And even if you're not gonna buy it, check it out online, the Filament Bible. It's done by Tyndale, I think. What it is the Bible written, if you look, it's written like a book. So on the inside, if you look, it's not broken into two sections. It's written like a novel, okay? It doesn't have, it has the chapters and verses and stuff, but it's not like obtrusive like you do in a lot of other Bibles. if you look on the sides over here, there's little plus signs. There's actually an app that goes with this too. So even though this is an easy to read and it's made for reading big sections of text, you use the your phone somehow to look up study parts, and they have videos that go with it. They have like Bible Project videos they link from it. They have study guides. They have cross references. If you want to nerd out, you can totally nerd out with this Bible, and it still makes it really easy to read. So this to me is like, this is the Bible to get. If you could get one that it's, like I said, easy to read and also satisfies your nerd side. I also wanted to show you this real quick, just so you, in case you wanted to know. These are actually books translated in from Senegal. This is Wolof. So in Senegal, we do a lot of work over there. They're translating the Bible into Wolof now. It's a task that's been taking forever. The paper's yellow because the sun's so bright. If you do it on white paper, you can't see the text, so everything's in yellow. And on the back, you'll see that it's written in Aramaic as well, because this is kind of a, not a trick, I don't want to say that, but Muslims are very interested in Arabic text, and they see it, they think it's the Quran, and so they're, ooh, what's that? And then you get an opportunity to say, ooh, this is the Bible, let me talk to you about it. So it's very, it's a trick. Oftentimes missionaries will take these and just set them down with the Aramaic up, and they'll be, ooh, what's that? They want to see it, and so they have a conversation. So the Bible's still being translated. The Bible is still being translated today into lots of different languages. So anyway, these are Bibles. I mean, you can read these if you want to. I can let you read them. I don't even know which books these are because I don't read Wolof. So, but they handed them to me, and I was very excited to get them. So check those books out. That's the end of commercial for a little bit of the Bible part. But I do want to talk about apps as well, some apps for your phone. So the first one I wanted to talk about was YouVersion. How many use the YouVersion Bible app on your phones? Yeah, okay. It's probably the most popular in the US. It's great. It has hundreds of downloadable translations of the Bible. There's thousands of devotionals on it. What's really cool about some of the devotionals, my wife and I did one for Lent, and it had a section where you read a devotional, and then a section where you read of scripture, and then it had a section where you can put your thoughts, like what do you think about this? And so we text in our thoughts, and we could do it at our own pace. So if I did mine in the morning and she did hers in the afternoon, it would show me when her notes popped up, and we can interact back and forth on this app without, you know, with actually doing a Bible study together without sitting side by side doing a Bible study together, because she doesn't like to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. So it saved our marriage. Just kidding. And another thing it does is it also can read you the Bible out loud if you're an auditory learner. Like some people I know put it in their headphones and they go work in the yard and they can listen to scripture. It's a really great opportunity. Now, another app that we used a few years ago was the Read Scripture app. Anybody remember doing that as a church a couple years ago? Yep, it has Bible Project videos and it has kind of an outline of how it goes. And every day there's a certain amount of reading. It takes about 15 to 20 minutes a day. And by the end of a year, I think before the end of a year, you can actually read through the whole Bible. And what's really great about it is the videos kind of help you make sense of what you're about to read. So it's not like you're jumping into something completely clueless. So I'd encourage you to check that out. Another one would be the Blue Letter Bible. Any Blue Letter Bible people in here? These are the Bible nerds, okay? So these are the people that there is no end to the depth that you can go to. You want to read it in, you'll see what this word is in Hebrew. You can click on it and just dive in and be lost for days. Kind of like, I know a lot of us get lost in YouTube. You can get lost in the Bible in this. It has everything from encyclopedias, reading plans, resources, commentaries, maps, Hebrew and Greek references, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It is a great resource, Blue Letter Bible. They definitely do, it does read to you as well. I know that one does as well. Now, in addition to all these things, I wanted to talk about some book recommendations because, well, I can't, and I'm kind of a book guy. So if you were to ask me what my favorite book is, I'm moving again. All right. There are four books that I would suggest, okay? So the first one is, anybody read anything by Henry Nouwen? The Way of the Heart, okay? This is the shortest book. It's short. You can read it in a day, but I promise you, you will not finish it in a day because it will make you stop, and you have to ponder it. This book changes lives. It's an incredible book. And Henry Nouwen, if you just read about him, his story is incredible. Another one I would read about is Surprised by Hope. This is by N.T. Wright, another book that I suggest all the time. I've talked about N.T. Wright. He's an awesome scholar. And this, I think, encapsulates the walk of a Christian, the idea of our basic theology in a really great way. Dallas Willard, anybody read anything by Dallas Willard? Life Without Lack, okay? This guy was an incredible philosopher, C.S. Lewis of our time, really. I mean, he passed away a few years ago. Actually, a lot of years ago now. I'm old. But this is a great book. This is actually, he goes through the 23rd Psalm and kind of walks through how it impacted his life and kind of how we should reference it as well. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful book. And then Francis Chan, anybody? Crazy Love. Okay, this is the book. This super easily readable. Just really talks about your walk with God and how much God loves you. Now, I suggest these four books to everybody. In fact, I had to borrow this one because I've given away all my Crazy Love book copies. But the reason I suggest all of those is because I assume that everyone, in addition to reading their Bible, is reading My Utmost for His Highest. Anybody read this book before? Okay. Oswald Chambers? Okay, I've been reading this for over 5 years. This is actually the copy that my mentor, Jim Christensen, gave to me back in 2015. I've been reading this for 5 years, and it still speaks to me today. This is my favorite book outside of the scriptures. It is an incredible book. If you haven't done it, it's a daily devotional. It goes through the whole year, and what I do is I just go through a whole year and then start it back up again and just keep going and going and going. Something cool about that book: there's an app for that. So you can download the app. I think it costs $5. Download the app, and it reminds you about things. It has the daily devotional on there. It has words of wisdom. It has suggestions for reading plans. It has everything on it you could possibly want and more. My Utmost for His Highest. Let's make that a regular reading. If you ever want to start a conversation with me and you don't know what to talk about because you're an introvert too, you can always come over to me and you could say, what did you think of Oswald this morning? And we'll have a conversation. So that will be a thing. So I don't miss a day. I feel like Oswald speaks to every generation. It's incredible. It's for as old as it is, it's incredible. All right, commercial over. Are we good? Too much? Okay. I like how they turn the lights off. We're like, we're done over there now. Well done. Okay. So what I want to do here is start us off now on what a teacher would call a book walk through the book of Acts, okay? I'm going to stick to my notes and stuff, but I'd encourage you, please, to open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 1, okay? When you do a book walk, we're not reading word for word and going through every bit of text. That would take too long. It might be fun, but we'd be here a long time. So we're looking at, like, the titles and the things we notice. Like, does the book, like, look like, does it orient itself like poetry, or does it orientate it like something else? What are the words in red, if you have a Bible that has Jesus' words in red and things like that? So you often just look for things that pop out to you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of walk through the story of Acts, and we'll dig in on little parts, and then we'll back away again. And just, I would encourage you, don't look at me. I'm not that attractive anyway. So just look at the Bible and kind of follow along, just looking at the big picture. And I'll mention, oh, hey, we're in chapter 6 now, and just kind of flip over and see how the story progresses and see how the story progresses and see how the story progresses, okay? Again, we're going to do 30,000 feet, so it's not going to be in there too deep too quickly, so don't get worried about getting stuck. Okay, if you don't have your Bibles, you can always look on the Jumbotron up here for the parts we're reading, but other than that, you're really missing out on looking at the book in its entirety. So the book opens, if you look at the first part, it opens with an introduction, right? And we read the introduction to Luke last week, okay? And we talked, this one's very similar, about the purpose for writing, where he talks about how he goes, in my previous writing, remember these were one book, Luke Acts was one book, in my previous writing, I'd written about Jesus, all that he'd done up to this point. And now he talks about how he's tagging off of that story to talk about how the Holy Spirit comes to fill God's people and that story. So he kind of gives this brief little introduction. And then we start with this scene outside of Jerusalem, where Jesus is about to ascend, okay? And the apostles, they've spent 40 days with him after his resurrection, and they still don't really understand what's going to happen. So they ask Jesus a question in verse 6, okay? It says, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? So they had this mindset that this kingdom that Jesus talked about constantly, the kingdom is at hand, remember all that talk? Only really included Israel, even though since the very beginning in the Old Testament, the plan was that it be through Israel that all people would be blessed, right? You were blessed so that you can be a blessing to all people. That was the plan from the beginning. And then, so Jesus, I don't know if it's out of frustration or what, but he responds to this question, and I think one of the greatest quotes in the Bible, he says, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. Now, I didn't research this a lot, but to me, I feel like this is Aramaic for y'all need to mind your own business. I think. He then goes on to say what is Luke's thesis statement for the entire book of Acts. This is the verse, the thesis statement. He says to his disciples, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. This is the thesis statement. This is what all of the books of Acts is going to hinge on. It's going to talk about this the whole time. Now, for us in our modern day to fully understand this statement, we have to put on our first century Second Temple Judaism glasses. Jesus is going to ascend to heaven to be next to the Father again, right? He's going to go. Now, God did this before, didn't he? Do you remember that? You remember how God descended to live in the tabernacle and then in the temple when it was completed? And then in Ezekiel, we see that the Spirit of God leaves the temple. Do you remember that? The second temple gets built, but do we ever see God descend again? We don't. They start the practices, they start doing all the things they did at the old temple, but we never saw a time when God descended until Jesus came. And this is what John is talking about when he talks about in John 1:14. He says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt. That word dwelt is tabernacled. He tabernacled. He lived among. He came and to be with us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. So to a Second Temple Jew, this would have been brought to mind God himself descending to be amongst his people again as he did in the tabernacle way back in Exodus. So when Jesus is about to ascend to heaven, how are they feeling? Not again. Don't leave us again. You left us for hundreds of years before. Don't leave us again. Don't leave us again. Don't leave us again. But Jesus tells them that the Holy Spirit is coming down, and they will receive power, and they will have these new identities. He gives them a new identity as witnesses for what he's doing, and he tells them they will be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And I honestly think these first disciples didn't hear any of this. They're like, yeah, whatever. You're going where? Why are you leaving? Now, if I were to break the book of Acts down into sections, I'd break it down into three major sections. Now, the first section would be the institution of this new temple in the people of God, actually within the people of God. So if you move down the page in your Bible, we see that Jesus ascends to the throne, which is Daniel 7, right? There's the reference there, okay? And then the Holy Spirit shows up, doesn't he? And how does the Holy Spirit show up? Fire and wind. Right? Fire and wind. Do you remember back in Exodus 40, 2 Chronicles 7, how did God descend when he descended on the temple? Fire. Fire. Yeah. What does the word wind mean in Greek? Wind or breath? We've talked about this a few years, last summer, I think. Spirit. Spirit. This is the Spirit. This is God. And where is he falling down on? The people of God. This is a new temple. This would have, in these Jewish minds, they would have got it right away. And they would have been so excited. That's why everyone thought they were drunk. Remember? You don't remember that part? We'll get to that eventually. Okay? Yeah, it means Spirit and the fire and the Spirit. Now, if we keep scanning along in the book, we see that the next thing that happens is Peter preaches at Pentecost, right? To all the gathered Jews from all over the world, and he's speaking in their languages. Remember this speaking in tongues part. And many come to faith. And how cool is this? This is great because what's happening here is that Israel is reunified under the messianic king, Jesus, as was prophesied back in Isaiah and Ezekiel. The temple where God comes to live is no longer in a building, but in his people. Now, Luke illustrates this major shift because if we keep going, keep flipping the pages, what you'll see happening, what happens, starts happening next? They start healing people, don't they? They start meeting day by day, doing fellowship together in their homes, don't they? They start taking care of the poor. Where did that stuff happen before this? The temple. They're doing temple business as the people of God. How do you think the Jewish leaders loved this? It was their favorite. I'm just kidding, no. So what happens is they start to face persecution, don't they? So in chapters 8 through 12, we see this primarily Jewish community of Jesus become this multi-ethnic international community. We see that Philip the Samaritan, Simon the Magician, which is a really cool name if you're looking for a kid's name, the Ethiopian eunuch, not as cool a name, Saul the Jewish persecutor, okay? All these people come to faith during these times, okay? And Peter has this crazy dream. Remember the sheet with all the stuff you're supposed to eat and all this craziness? And he's like, no, I'm not going to eat that stuff because that's gross. And I've never eaten that. Okay? He has these crazy dreams. And then he's told to go meet up with this Roman centurion, this oppressor, right? The person who's oppressing the Jewish people. And then he sees something. He sees the Spirit in chapter 10 come upon Gentiles. And like a good thinking man, Peter goes to research this. Am I crazy or is this happening everywhere? In chapter 11, he goes around and starts researching. Hey, is this happening over there? Yeah, it's happening over here too. What's happening? The Gentiles are getting filled with the Holy Spirit. What do we do with that? We have no framework for this. They're not the people of God. What do we do? So he goes back to Jerusalem, and they have big conversations about circumcision. We talked about that last week. I'm not going to go through that again. Now, what happens here is that Gentiles are becoming Christians. Jews are becoming Christians. And at this time, there's a church in Antioch that began to see growth as it became this first multi-ethnic church. And that's the first place where Christians are called Christians. And Barnabas is the pastor of this church, and he invites this new convert, Saul, to come and work with him. So Paul is working alongside Barnabas, learning about the things of God, because he's a Jewish scholar, and he's learning about how to follow Jesus and what it looks like to pastor a church. Now, in chapter 13, we begin another section, where these are the missionary journeys of Paul and Barnabas. They preached in synagogues, and they go on street corners. They saw Jewish and Gentile people coming to faith. And while amazing things were happening, there was also this mounting persecution. Like I said, the Jewish leaders would be really angry with his people, but they couldn't really do anything to him anymore. They were getting so popular, they didn't know what to do. Now, so what they did is they started rallying other people who worshipped Roman and Greek gods, and they were like, hey, these guys aren't worshipping your gods. Did they care about these other gods? No, not at all. They were just using these people. Now, eventually, this Christian movement becomes known for being a Jewish messianic movement that is ethnically diverse. It's known for being a family where men and women sit together in church, where women are educated and treated with highest respect as equals, where rich and poor people dine at the same table and share with one another. It's where slaves and free people, slaves can sit with their masters and worship their God together. And they're all treated like equals. It's known as a church who is loyal to Jesus alone, but it's not like what they expected, because churches like this, they expected to rise up and overtake Rome, right? But it's not like anything they'd ever seen before, because these guys were obedient to the ruling authorities. They didn't go about overthrowing the government or standing up for their rights. They were obedient. They paid their taxes. They obeyed the laws that didn't conflict with them preaching the gospel. And even enduring unjust flogging, Paul got beat so many times because they just didn't know what to do with him, so they beat him up. Was it just? Never. They would say, we have nothing on him. Let's beat him and let him go. What? How unjust is this? That's what they do. But they would endure this all the time. Now, the Jewish leaders wanted to squash the movement, but they struggled with its growing popularity. The culture at large was angry because as people came to faith, people who would profit from pagan practices, ultimately it harmed their economy. They're taking money out of my pockets. I don't care what you believe, but buy my idols still. The Romans, they got all these people bringing these Christians to court and saying, hey, you need to do something about these guys. And they're like, they're not doing anything wrong. I don't know what to do with these guys. What do you do with a church like this? Now, eventually, Paul gets unjustly arrested in Acts 21. And the rest of the book of Acts, this third section, is where the rulers of the ancient world don't know what to do with this guy, because he's a Roman citizen. And they pass him around. So he goes from the Sanhedrin to Governor Felix, from Governor Felix to Governor Festus, from Governor Festus to King Agrippa, and no one can find anything to do with this guy. So they just flog him all the time and put him in jail, like house arrest. But God uses this time too. This is where we get most of the New Testament writings. Paul would write all the letters to all these churches. Now, by the end of the book, Paul's in Rome. And ultimately, this is where Paul will die. Church history says that Rome beheads him, but if you look at the end of the book of Acts, you don't see that in there. Instead, the story closes with Paul and his friends in Rome, and they're doing their ministry. And this is where I want to kind of close this section tonight, or today. So I want to look up at the end of 28:15. We're going to look at how the book of Acts closes, because it closes in a really weird way. We see that it says on 28 or 15b, it says, the Holy Spirit was right, and this is Paul talking to these Jewish leaders, the Holy Spirit was right in saying to your fathers through the Isaiah the prophet, go to this people and say, you will indeed hear, but never understand. You will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart, the Israelites' hearts that were not turning, has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. God's heart is still for these people, these Israelites. Paul says, therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles because they will listen. Heartbreaking. It then finishes up the closing verses in the chapter. It says, Paul, he lived there 2 whole years at his own expense. When you're under house arrest, you had to pay for your own house. And welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. The end. That's just how it ends. You'd think that it would wrap up with the story of Paul's death. Okay, that makes sense. He would die. But it just sort of ends. And I think this is intentional on behalf of Luke. The book ends because it doesn't end there. The church does not end. The book ends, but the church doesn't. We know that from church history that all of the apostles went on missionary journeys far and wide. Check out, there's a book called The Book of Martyrs. Check it out. It talks about how all the apostles died and where they ended up. Great story. Thomas, one of my favorites, okay? Really good story about what he does in India. He dupes a king out of a bunch of money to build a castle, but he builds churches. And then, I'm telling this story, I shouldn't be telling this, but he built churches instead, and then when the king's like, what the heck, man, you're supposed to build me a castle, he goes, I built you a castle in heaven. So he killed him. But it was such a great, like, he totally duped this king out of money. Anyway, so there's great stories about these apostles going far and wide, doing these amazing things, and you're like, why doesn't the book of Acts keep going? Did Luke die? No, I don't think so. I think it's left open for us, because we're the recipients of this gospel, aren't we? God has used this early church to bring about the good news, the gospel, to us and our generation. But furthermore, we're not just recipients, we are participants in that the Holy Spirit is still working through us to reach the whole world throughout all time. We are Acts 29. The book continues. The Holy Spirit continues his work through us. So next week, we're going to begin starting a new series called Beautiful Community. And you're like, gosh, CJ, really? Acts 2:42 again? I'll probably reference it. I'm not going to lie. It just happens, okay? But that's not what the whole series is about. This series, we're going to go really look at how the early ancient community of Christ followers lived their lives. How they had this faithful distinction. How the Holy Spirit added day by day to those who were being saved. But it's because their whole lives were transformed. They rethought about how they did church. They became increasingly transparent with one another, embracing this identity that they had in Christ and believing that the Holy Spirit can transform them. So I am not my sinful nature. I am transformed by God, and I am a witness to his glory. They prioritized the mission in their daily lives, living for Jesus in their homes and schools and workplaces and communities. They also did friendship differently. I don't even know if we know how to do friendship now. They loved one another. They were dedicated to one another. Their relationships were centered on Jesus. They lived in unity with one another. We don't have any clue how to even be civil, much less live in unity in our modern world. They lived lives that were all about others and not about themselves. They lived self-sacrificially like their Savior did. They were so committed to one another that they would die for one another. They celebrated with one another. This is a community of joy. They had parties all the time. It was very confusing to the watching culture. So these are the aspects of this early church that we're going to look over the next few weeks. Now, our hope is that by looking back, we can kind of look within ourselves and ask the Holy Spirit, transform us, help us to become more and more like this. But I also hope that we can look to the future, that what the Holy Spirit might do in the future through us, a continuation of this early church, a living out of Acts 29, as Jesus continues his ministry. Sound good? All right, let's pray. Father God, wow, we did the book of Acts in one day. I guess we're done. Just kidding. Father God, what a beautiful, beautiful thing to be able to gather with my brothers and sisters, to be able to look to your word, to look at the overarching themes even in the book of Acts, Father. You speak even through overarching themes. It doesn't have to be in the nitty-gritty word for word, Greek and Hebrew, but you speak to us in these English words that you are not just the one who wrote the scriptures through these authors and speak to us from back then, but you speak now. I pray that we'd be a people that look for you in your word, Father, that we might be a studying people and an encouraging people, a nerdy group of people that are chasing after you with all that we are, Father. Thank you for today and for the opportunity to be able to start this journey together. May we be Acts 29, Father. Use us. Forgive us for how we've tried not to be used. We've embraced things that we shouldn't embrace. Let's focus our eyes on you all together, Father, and be your church and do your will in this world at this time. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand and continue with us in worship as we sing about God's great faithfulness? On stage to do our prayer of reflection.
Please join me in prayer. God, I thank you for this time and opportunity we get to spend together learning about your word and plans for our lives through Pastor CJ. Lord, I thank you for the sermon almost 2 years ago and the encouragement Pastor CJ gave to read my Bible daily through the Read Scripture app. God, you know how fearful I was to fail, to let myself down with another failed resolution, but you gave me the strength and determination to start each day with my coffee in hand and the Read Scripture app. God, my heart soared as I soaked up your words and realized your plan for me. In 6 short months from the start of this journey with my morning Bible time, I began feeling less afraid. I started to see my life more clearly and was able to leave a toxic job and was led to a teaching job here at Adventureland Preschool. I've seen your hand in my relationships and a growth in my relationships with my church family here. I've continued to read my Bible daily. After I finished the APPS program, I found a desire to dive deeper into your word, learning and studying what I read, and finally realizing those words written so long ago actually apply right now in my life. I thank you, God, for changing my life through this small app on my phone, growing my faith and my friendships and knowledge in you. Lord, after all you have given us and blessed our lives with, I ask that as we bring our offerings to you and our church, help us to give cheerfully and gratefully as you have given so much to us. Lord, help anyone questioning to read their Bible or download this app to make the commitment. Lead them to peace and freedom from fear as you did for me. Thank you, God, for all you have given to us. Let us go out these doors today with hope and a desire to live more closely with you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Say every time I can tell a song's really rocking when you look back at the worship team back there, or the tech team back there, and they're all dancing, doing their thing. Norm was doing his head bob. I love it. Anyway, it was great. Sorry, I didn't want to call you guys out, but you know, that's what I do. Thank you for wherever you're worshiping from. Thank you so much. Cammie's story, awesome. I just wanted to say amen and let's go home. So who's Acts 29? We are, that's right. So let's go be it. Let's pray. Father God, let's go be Acts 29 of this world, Father. You've blessed us, encouraged us, gifted us, saved us, Father, that we might be recipients, but not just recipients, but we be participants, Father, in what you're doing in this world. May we be your people in our families, in our workplaces, in our schools, in our community, Father. May we express your love to all those, this hurting world that needs it. In your son's name we pray. Amen.